reason why we chose the year 1886 is because of everything that happened before, but also what's going to happen after. Life changed from the Industrial Revolution in 1848 all the way through, really, to the First World War.
The Victorian era, the city itself, the booming Industrial Revolution, you're kind of on the cusp of the modern era. At the same time, you sort of have this, like, lingering sense of mysticism.
We definitely drew from a lot of that stuff. I remember being enamored with the whole idea of Camelot and the Knights of the Round Table, something that was not religious, but really, you know, about humanity.
If you look at the Arthurian legend, I mean, there's some of them that go back to pre-Roman Celtic, and we wanted to get that kind of Celtic lineage back into the oldest part of the order.
It's so rich with the lore, with those interaction and people, these noble knights basically protecting humanity, and it was like, well, if we could meld a story like that, if we build those people, if we build something that is slightly outside the bounds of reality, can we make it real enough?
We want that kind of double take where it feels like the 1886 that was, but then kind of out of the corner of your eye, it's like, well, there's certain things where we deliberately kind of deviate from history just to have that balance between getting that first read of believability and sort of the second read of, wow, that's kind of cool and different.
We tried to echo a lot of things that were true of the time. We didn't want to recreate history, we wanted to twist it.
We just pored over kind of the history of the era, maps, the layout of London.
Understanding the city, understanding really how it was laid out.
We went to London with 20 people, location scouting and shooting extensive amounts of photos.
If you hadn't been there, you have to go there to understand what life is like, what it feels like to walk in the streets, because a lot of it still exists.
There's so much history. You can kind of see the layers of time and the layers of architecture built on top of each other, even at that time.
We pored over period costumes and did photo shoots, not only capturing all the intricate details of the costumes, but also how people moved in them.
A lot of European militaries at that time, they had these just a lot of craftsmanship, a lot of symbols and patches and a lot of embroidery.
The cording, the armored gorgets and bracers, like those are things we really spent a lot of time kind of poring over reference, but then kind of inject all of our lore to kind of craft these specifically for these characters and for this order.
When we started actually, you know, melding this fiction and nonfiction, there was the need to make sure that we had some control over it.
We early on had a lot of elements that were kind of more fantastic. It was very tempting and very easy early on to go, like, if we're gonna do alternate history, let's alter the world a lot.
The risk of approaching a game like this and bringing that balance between fiction and nonfiction, once you've basically, you know, broken that suspension of disbelief, there is no, you know, buying it back from the player.
That kind of undermined the reality and the believability of the situations and the characters, and then it was kind of like all bets are off.
We didn't want everything to be kind of pushed into alternate history. So more often than not, modes of transportation are the same, like horse-drawn carriages. But then there's technologies like airships that it did exist in that era, but we kind of pushed them ahead in the time frame.
We brought in things that were potentially, you know, 2-3 decades ahead of its time, brought them back into the 1886 era.
We were able to keep the overall kind of skyline of London, but then you see certain things like the mooring towers with the airships and the searchlights with them that give you this kind of layered, kind of alternate twist to the feeling of the world.
And that's really the doctrine we follow throughout the game. It's asking the question of whether or not people today that live today could believe the fiction that we're adding into our history.
That's something that sort of ties everything together to make it feel like an era that existed kind of out of place in time.
What's so fascinating about history is that regardless of all the fiction we write, I don't think it's ever as mysterious as history has been. You can go back and read books about events that have happened in the past, and they're really never 100% true. There's always something that actually is slightly off. That gave us so much ammunition, basically, to build this IP and building that narrative and making this game feel like you're actually living through it. We wanted people to understand how it was to live in that world and to experience the differences in our history firsthand through the eyes of somebody who has seen that history as well. Building these characters in an IP and in a story is one thing, but bringing them to life is everything. If they don't come to life, it doesn't really matter how much you write. And that was the nice balance between having a story to tell and building a playable character.
When you think about video game development, design isn't necessarily where most people would think about character and acting, but we challenge our designers every day that they think about that, because it's gonna come across. You know, even when we're setting up a scenario for gameplay reasons, we wanna make sure that each of those beats and those moments is gonna contribute something to the characters.
So starting out, we usually start with kind of the archetype of what we wanted to convey with the character's emotion and personality.
The first character that we started was Galahad as more of the dark, hero in the trench coat.
We wanted them to have a kind of rugged, battle-hardened warrior feel, but at the same time have some sense of three-dimensionality to the character.
Sir Galahad, this matter is not yet over.
Of that you can be sure.
Galahad is the knight who has lived long enough to actually understand life, understand, you know, relationships and all that, but also become, in so many ways, immune to all of it. He's built a wall.
A proper knight must learn to curb his passions.
Without passion, monsieur, a man cannot fight.
We do not fight men, Marquis.
Galahad is kind of a little bit more serious. Lafayette, you know, he's new, he's young, so there's a bit more of a kind of eagerness. He's a little bit more of a risk taker.
Men, half-breeds, what does it matter? Vive la liberté!
He's a modern-day man. I mean, he brings a little bit of levity to the situation, but for all his joviality, he also has lived through two wars that have probably taught him in his position more than anybody could have even in a few hundred years.
As the kind of apprentice training knight, we wanted a nice contrast with him and the kind of more seasoned knights in the order.
Do you trust anyone, mon général? Never accept, always question.
Sebastian Mallory is one of the elder knights. He has lived long enough that he's seen a lot more than anybody else, practically.
And so he just had the kind of poise and this sense of kind of this grizzled veteran.
Stopped for a pint, did you?
We kind of kept him a little, not plain, but he's a little bit more simple in design. I always looked at him as kind of the old school guy who didn't need all that frilly stuff.
We need eyes on the ground amongst the guests.
And imagine me with nothing to wear.
The moniker Lady Green was given to Isabeau d'Argyle, and she, in our world, is the youngest knight to ever join the order at her age.
Her and Galahad have history together, and so we kind of can feel some of that distance that they've had, but at the same time, things are clicking again. You're starting to see them kind of like old times.
I'd prefer to have someone more experienced looking out for me.
I thought you needed no looking after.
She's a grounding force to a lot of people. She speaks her mind. She's as strong and as deft and as, you know, skillful as Galahad is.
Do try not to lag behind.
It wouldn't make sense to do the typical video game busty, curvy woman, and especially it wouldn't be accurate to the time. I mean, if you looked at the dresses, I mean, they barely had an ounce of skin showing, so we really had to be more creative with her design.
So on the other end was, you know, how we take kind of broader facial structure and archetype and get it on a highly emotive face that runs in real time.
One of the hardest part about characters is that, you know, we're humans, we're people, and our brain is really trained at recognizing any little flaws or inconsistencies that you would see in another human.
We have to deal with almost every facet of human anatomy to make sure it looks correct. We scan the 3D face of an actor, and then we take that in-house and we manipulate it, make it slight mutations to make it our character. Every animation of the humans in-game is mo-capped, and we have head cams mounted on the actor, so we get simultaneous body and facial performance.
Most fetching, was she not?
I hadn't noticed.
That is because you are not a Frenchman.
You are the most American Frenchman I have ever known.
I am a lover of liberty, mon ami.
One of the bigger challenges comes from the fact that our characters' performances that we try to make very authentic and very real is being delivered on a set that is a big gray carpet with tons of, you know, really intense bright lights. They're wearing spandex suits with headgear on that has a head-mounted camera that's capturing the face. Working with the people, as far as the virtual experience is concerned, is actually probably the most challenging.
Tell every available knight to converge towards Whitechapel.
It's always going to be a balance. It's always going to be a balance of going too far with it, where people feel like, okay, I really want mechanics, or too little with it, where they get mechanics but they don't get context and immersion. But it's been a great balance, actually, that we've been able to achieve in the last few years.
There is no, like, magical ingredient to the process. It's just a lot of blood, sweat, and tears. But I think the end result, it really gives a sense of believability and personality of the characters.
Roy, where are you going?
To finish what we started.
This is no time for vengeance. Cut your senses.
The technology of being able to make these characters believable and realistic creates that, I think, that opportunity for us to kind of sit there and make the nuances count and make the things that you maybe would normally skip over for a video game and not really dwell on the little human beats. We try to make sure that those are really woven into the game, because for us it really matters.
In the history of the studio, we've always built our own engine, and it's something that it can be a blessing and a curse. It's slower to get up and running in the project because everything has to be built up from scratch, but you have much more control over
how the engine is kind of accomplishing the goals of the games and IP you're making.
It's always been important for us to have our own technology at Ready at Dawn because we have a vision of what we want the game to be and where we want the story to go, but we also have a vision of where we want the technology to go.
So when you're starting a new engine, what you try to do is you try to build on something else, that either that's experience, another engine entirely, or in our case, we had a PSP working engine. On the PSP, it's how do we make it smaller? How do we kind of condense it? How do we streamline it? On the PS4, everything is how do I make it bigger? How do I make it faster? How do I make it more in your face?
My feeling was that for this generation, a big distinguishing factor was going to be just how much more alive a game level should feel.
We want every part of it to look like it belongs and feels kind of real and lifelike. We want it to look like it's a real living, breathing environment. And there's a lot of parts to that.
Whether it's smoke, things blowing in the wind, everything that is moving in the game interacts volumetrically and correctly with the air in the environment. When our characters are standing there and, you know, the wind is blowing and you get this, the coat flapping in a physically correct manner, whether you even understand why it looks better than you've seen before, it just registers, you know. The player doesn't know why, but it looks better, it looks more realistic.
It's taken a lot of time and a lot of effort, but we've started to get, you know, really realistic movement to the cloth.
You see how they move, you see how they behave, you see how they feel, how they respond to light differently. And so a lot of that was a ton of research into period accurate material.
For every like little, you know, glint on a material or things like that, every bit of texture, we scan lots of textiles to get that sort of real world look embedded into our materials.
And so that was actually kind of challenging, is finding those materials in today's societies, because we have a lot of synthetic materials now.
Using a 3D scanning process, we took reams and reams of these kind of historically accurate textiles and digitized them down to sub-millimeter precision, which just has all the imperfections and also artistry that is really hard to kind of simulate from scratch.
We actually have specialized cloth shading technology to make it look right and sit well in the scene and make it so that when you see it, it just looks like cloth and it doesn't look like a plastic tarp wrapped around the guy.
We really put a huge investment in terms of our material model and the lighting that reveals it. Those two things really go hand in hand.
I think over the last 5 years, the industry, both, you know, movie industry and the gaming industry, has kind of transitioned into a more like physically accurate lighting model.
So game lighting tends to be very kind of forward diffuse lighting versus kind of glancing and getting the variation in wetness and sheen in material properties. So instead of having full-on direct lights that just illuminate the full face of a character, you have glancing lights that are catching kind of imperfections and implying form.
We've spent a lot of time getting a good volumetric look to our lighting and our fog system so that it can really, it creates a kind of mood and atmosphere.
The world we're in, especially, you know, foggy London, fluid and fog and these dense atmospheres and grime and soot are all very difficult anomalies to actually model.
Even London today, you know, the fog is a common element. But if you look at the Industrial Revolution, it's like you had fog and you had booming industry, you had soot, you had pollution. It was almost like another character in our world.
Yeah, I think in the past, games kind of used fogs to clip out draw distances because they couldn't render as much. And so they just said they'd bring the fog plane in, and maybe on PCs, if you had a really boss video card, you could crank that dial back up and you could see further and further.
And now we're using it to accent the world and some of the players to really get the life and the feeling of everything there.
It gives it this kind of living, breathing, immersive quality that actually gives more depth to the world because it's so integral to making the characters and world feel cohesive and of that place and time.
When there's a certain tone in the story, a lot of it doesn't just come from what the characters say or even just from the actors and their motion capture. A lot of it comes from the environment. It comes from the lighting and sort of the atmosphere.
Any one thing seems kind of inconsequential, but as you see the meticulous kind of research and all those little details add up, the overall experience is something that conveys that level of detail.
I don't think there's a single element that we're like, well, let's not go there because the hardware's not powerful enough. It was the door was open in any field, and we were like, okay, well, let's try to innovate as many fields as possible.
Really, the limit is not the technology anymore. It's not, certainly not the platform. You can do anything.
Like, you can really set out a kind of a blank slate and say, what do we want to do differently? What do we think is really key to this new generation of hardware?
Which to the end user and to the game and to the gamer means that we are giving them the best experience that we can. We're giving them the most physics that we can, the most graphics that we can, the most animation and AI work.
And so what we're able to do is we're able to tailor each of those systems to maximize the hardware to give them the best outward experience, because now we're doing stuff that wasn't before possible.
You have a truly cinematic, immersive, you know, experience with characters that you care about, with environments that, you know, blow your mind, that look so painterly and so beautiful and so interesting that you actually want to spend time in that world.
We are at war all the time, still today. After thousands of years, we still go to war. We still are, you know, people that like to fight, conquer, and that's the way we live. One thing that we thought of at the very beginning was, what if war wasn't against one society against another, one religion against another, you know, one people against another people? What if you segmented the race that we are and formed something that is partly us, but not really like us? The half-breeds were formed out of that.
By this point, hundreds and hundreds of years of struggle has already kind of occurred between humans and the half-breeds. Basically, our story kind of paints them as another top-tier predator, just like man is.
The half-breeds are based on lore that exists from stories that were told in different countries, in different civilizations, societies. In our world, werewolf is something that came from a lore that they probably believed in thousands of years ago, when it actually was a half-breed, an evolution of mankind.
They still are, I would say, anatomically similar to humans, but they have, you know, there's obviously, they're much taller, they're bigger, they have hides that are thicker, their musculature gets slightly augmented.
The reason why the lycans and that particular species of half-breed is a threat, it was a question of understanding what it was about the werewolf lore that is as intelligent as you are, but is as bestial as a wolf could be.
I think, to me, the most terrifying thing is that we try to basically always have some degree of a performance in them that carries a level of intelligence. They are smart. I think, to me, that's actually the scariest thing about them. And when something can look at you, size you up, and be at your equal, if not above you, I think it becomes very, very scary.
We really tried to capture the right balance of both human lupine anatomy and that level of imperfection that makes it not feel like this kind of action-y comic book creature, and much more like this is a creature that could have existed that we just haven't seen yet.
The anatomy has to be right. If it doesn't look like it's built for the purpose that it needs to serve, it's gonna look kind of artificial. You know, you don't want something to look like a man in a suit. You don't want something to just have weird kind of bones jutting out of it just because that looks cool or scary.
Also trying to retain a sense of the person. We didn't want this magical transformation from specific guy to generic scary creature. We wanted a sense of who that person was still kind of transferred into the lichen anatomy.
We knew that one of the kind of the pillars of the game was that we not just have lichens, but we have the ability to transform a human into a lichen or vice versa. We wanted no cheats. We wanted continuous no-cut shots of this happening. And so what that means is actually transforming the anatomy.
The blood from the heart through the veins and arteries, you kind of see this chest expansion as if maybe the lungs, the rib cage, and then all the rest of it as it's being carried through the blood kind of moves outwards to the extremities.
The hips, the pelvis, the big toes of the humans actually morphs and migrates back to the dew claw.
Everything is very, very different from how the thing is structured.
Finding 3D topology that allowed us to achieve that was quite a process.
And then the hair growth was another challenge. As they're transforming, a mostly bald human is now transforming into a very hairy dog, cat-like creature.
On top of that, the skeletons of both characters are actually animating and transforming along with this blend shape. On top of that, the materials are animating and blending between the human state, sort of an in-between transformation state and the lichen state without any tricks or gimmicks.
I think that's something that people are gonna be really kind of excited about. You know, there's that moment where you're like, oh man, turning into a lichen, this is awesome. And so we wanted to make sure we play that up. But once you feel like that thing makes sense and that it could really stand in front of you, I think there's this whole other layer of kind of emotion that sets in where you're like, wow, that's not just this thing that I take for granted as being a monster or something just, ooh, scary. It's like, that maybe could be something that, you know, we just haven't found in the world. They're in hiding, we don't know where they are.
It's always a struggle because everybody was like, should we push it a little more? It's like, no, you know, guys, let's make it believable. Let's keep it in the realm of what people are gonna say. You know what, I don't believe in them, but if I did, that's what I would have believed. The Order was originally formed as a means to go hand in hand and fight against the half-breeds. Humanity was at the time at war with the half-breeds, and they had a hard time surviving. The half-breeds were fewer, but they were definitely more powerful.
At this point in the story, the Order has realized that in order for them to finally win the battle over the half-breeds, they have to commission the best weapon makers there are in the world to make the things that they need to fight whatever it was that they were coming up against.
And that war that remains the status quo for the better part of, like, you know, 1,000 years, suddenly changes with the Industrial Revolution, because now that equilibrium is changed by machinery and inventions.
We started looking at what are the things that we think are interesting to propel something, to weaponize something.
It took a lot of iteration to get something that looked, had the craftsmanship of the period, but also you had this alternate technology that you had to integrate into just the basic assault rifle.
There's definitely prototype weaponry at that time where some of the guns makers were developing automatic weapons out of their semi-automatic weapons. So we thought a rifle that was fully automatic was something that they would have figured out.
Designing, you know, the Knight's kind of a bread and butter, which is the combo rifle. That was kind of the challenge of, you know, just looking at all the issued rifles through all the ages and Industrial Revolution up to World War II and trying to pick the tone of what we wanted to hit. So we attempted to make a Victorian version of the AK-47 plus this kind of alternate fire.
At the time, they had originally called, there was something called a combo gun, but it was a rifle shotgun setup, so we kind of took the name, leaving the form factor of the kind of master key setup and changing the shotgun out for something that delivered kind of like a concussive blast.
There's plenty of conventional weaponry that feels like it fits in that era, but then there's a little more kind of prototype weapons that are definitely kind of pushed in terms of what was available in the time.
For years, I've been watching videos like online of, you know, thermites, this cool thing, and, you know, people don't really know much about it, but you ignite this aluminum oxide powder and it turns into this big, like, sparking, you know, thing that can weld, it can cut. That's exciting. Let's figure out how to make that.
It kind of spits out projectile thermite pellets that you can spray anywhere, and then you take a high temperature flare, throw it into that cloud, and then it ignites everything.
You could do it in that order, but what if you were to actually fire the flare first, set that up, and then spray the thermite after? It's got multiple different ways that you could play it. That's interesting. So we just kind of kept on going down that path of figuring out what things that maybe, you know, don't get a lot of exploration in other games for weapon ideas.
We wanted to make sure nothing felt contrived. So we went to a meticulous level of research and trying to find, as we're putting together these slightly fantastical devices, how we can make them feel grounded in the technology of the era.
We were looking at Edison and Tesla, and so we said, okay, well, electricity has got to be something that we play with, and everything's being electrified at the time period, so let's put that in one camp.
We've actually used Tesla as one of our main points of contact in the game. He provides weaponry, he provides devices that he invents, and sometimes based on actual real things that he's done.
Because he's kind of like, in our game, a little bit of a makeshift kind of MacGyver, you know, he's crafty. He doesn't necessarily put things together in the most beautiful way, but for him it makes sense.
You never cease to amaze, Nicola.
So we said, okay, maybe he took these leftover parts from a rifle, the forestock, and he just started whittling and cutting it down and adding some other pieces to it.
Even though there are gadgets and weapons that didn't exist in that time period, they're made from components and ideas and research that were available then.
Especially the arc gun, when it kind of unfurls and starts charging up.
And we thought, okay, well, it's kind of cool if maybe it spins up, generates electricity, and that thing then kind of stores itself along a Jacob's ladder-like apparatus that is also the aiming part of the weapon, and then that thing finds its way kind of arcing towards its target, and when it hits, it delivers, you know, so much energy that whatever it hits, pretty much it atomizes and blows it up.
People were developing these gadgets at, you know, a breakneck pace and not really considering kind of the safety of the user. We wanted to make it feel like it's sort of on the edge of what is safe to wield.
Especially some of the prototype weapons, where part of the allure of them to us was, that thing looks kind of unstable. That looks just as dangerous to the operator as it does to whoever's on the receiving end, you know? So that's kind of some of the fun of the weapons. While they don't necessarily look comical, we try to always make them look, like I said, you know, realistic and classy, that there's an element of kind of danger in some of them. They actually feel a little bit on the edge.
Even though there's sort of alternate angles to the history, we want sort of the first glance at the game to feel almost like it was out of a period film.
We looked to cinema to kind of give us the cues and things that we feel like people are just used to kind of being exposed to.
We have lived behind a lens for a whole lifetime. This is what we're used to.
As long as we are, you know, more or less replicating a cinematic experience, we should be replicating a cinematic experience. And even if it's subconscious, satisfy what the viewer expects to see on the screen.
We want the shots in the game to feel like they were actually shot on practical film.
So all those properties from distortion to film grain, exposure, all these things are actually modeled into each practical lens we use.
And you see certain discrepancies, certain imperfections that you excuse. Not only do you excuse them, if they didn't exist, it would make it feel real.
It feels comfortable and familiar to what you expect to see when you're going to the movie theater in terms of the quality of the visuals, even the defects in the visuals.
We wanted imperfections to the cameras. We wanted to make it feel like there's actual a person behind the lens. We don't want things to be clean. Like, we want to make sure we're framing the action at the right moment, but it feels like a real person.
You're seeing bullet hits happening nearby and stuff, you know, kind of falling over them, like debris and stuff like that from stuff ricocheting. And we get those moments, you know, it's really cool to be that tight and see the character flinching and watch these puffs of smoke and little bits of rock or wood kind of get flung over him.
So if something kind of happens out of the peripheral vision, we want to build in to the camera a sense of personality. So the cameraman actually has a delay in reacting to it.
Visually, we wanted to make sure things weren't very sterile looking. It amps up all those things, and you feel a lot more like on edge the whole time.
There's all sorts of stylization you can do afterwards in terms of color grading, lighting, effects. On top of that, we add more stylization in terms of color correction and grading to kind of enhance the tone of what was initially shot. That's something that gives us a lot of control in post to be able to really hone the look of the game.
When you put all of this together, it was funny how well it just jived. It really is about that cinematic experience. That cinematic experience, it's melding one side of design, narrative design, with the mechanic design and trying to figure out a way to make it addictive.
In games, I don't think you've seen that look so much where you can actually feel like you're in a period film, so to speak, and you have an influence of that world and can kind of dwell in all the little interesting nuances of history and place and story.
The interesting thing about pushing that through and pushing that forward is to give players something that in so many ways they've been so accustomed to for so long.
And yet, it's, you know, displaying to you a new world and something you can actually interact with and something you want to spend time in.
When it came to addressing the idea of the score for the game, we knew that because it was a historical kind of alternate history game that we wanted to have an authenticity to the sound that, you know, had the allure of kind of the Victorian era, but at the same time, we didn't want to feel like we were kind of trapped or painting ourselves into a corner.
Just like the visuals seem like they could have happened, you know, in that time, but didn't quite, the music should feel the same way.
We thought about things like, you know, kind of augmenting instrumentation or kind of taking things and making them sound a little bit more uncomfortable than they normally would, and also kind of trying to bring some of that industrial feel into it that wouldn't have been something that musically would have been appreciated at the time period.
Music is an absolutely essential part of the experience in every way. The sound of the game is just as unique as the visual. It has its own identity. That was very important for us from the beginning, especially for a game like this that has such a unique, you know, unique look and unique feel to it. Yeah, you need to find someone that can not only understand, you know, the cinematic part, but the game part as well.
For me, inspiration for music comes really easy with games. One of the things that I love to do is visit the developer before I start writing any music. That means that I can immerse myself in the world that they've already been in for at least a year. So there's concept art and playthroughs, meeting the people. There was no lack of inspiration from the team at all.
So for our game, the score was something that I think really we kind of wanted something that had an air of kind of historical nature to it. You wanted to feel like it's kind of period-esque.
Given the time period that the game's set in, we're in the late 19th century, it seemed appropriate to have the full orchestral complement of live musicians, but we were very careful to keep it as authentic in terms of the acoustic instruments as possible. Everything's recorded live and everything's performed in real time. We wanted the musicians, the live breathing musicians, to really contribute that sense of emotion and weight to the score. Even our choice in recording studios played a prominent role in the sound of the overall score. We're here at Abbey Road, and Abbey Road has a beautiful Studio One, but we've chosen Studio Two, which is the smaller studio, and it has a really punchy, warm weight to it.
This is a big game, and it needed It needed a musical score that matched the scope and the scale of the visuals and of the vision.
If I had to choose one word to describe the music for The Order, it would probably be weight.
We wanted there to be this, like, this weight that is on all the characters, so that the world and the society at the time feels this burden of what's going on between, you know, the knights and the half-breeds.
When I'm first starting a project, the instrumentation is really the place that I like to start. And it's not even about what instruments I'm choosing, but what instruments I'm not choosing. One of the things that I thought would make this score stand apart from others is we have absolutely no brass. There's no heroic French horns or low, powerful trombones.
There are essentially no high woodwinds. There are like several bass clarinets, several contrabassoons, and bassoons. They provide this like low growl.
And another big aspect of it is the voices. We have a choir, which is 24 men, of course. No sopranos, no altos, no tenors either. So we essentially took the low 25% of the choir and extended it even lower.
We really kind of take it down. We get very, very kind of low bassy voices and stuff like that that make it creepy. And we get kind of like this strained, groaning kind of sound out of some of the performances that, when you see it in context with what's going on, it's very disturbing sounding.
I can smell you.
The biggest challenge, I think, as a game composer, is to come up with a sound for the game that is specific and unique to that franchise. That was something I really wanted to do for The Order, where you could hear 10 seconds of music and you could say, that's from The Order, and it doesn't sound like any other game.
Not just the thematic material, but just the orchestral colors that were chosen are very particular and very unique. Just hearing that theme, you know what that hero's experiencing, what the character's experiencing, and where the game is taking you.
To get a really well-crafted sound with all the elements that we're talking about, whether it's the score, or the ambient sound from the environment, or the weapons, or people, the idea of everything having its own space. Different elements kind of own their range, and then there's a certain clarity that comes from them. People can go, oh, I can kind of take it all in, and maybe they're not really, you know, focused on any individual part, but it all makes sense, and everything is kind of coming from a place where, you know, to our ears, fits.
We want something that people haven't heard before. We want an imprint. We want a sonority that people hear it and instantly think that's the sound of The Order.
This is for the players.